starting soon. Let's just do it. Let's just get this started. One thing I do want to get is YouTube. Let's just get this started. One thing I do want to... Wait, I need to mute this. It's the first thing. There we go. All right. We've been on a lot of chill, lo-fi, hip-hop, beat-free. We don't need that. The thing is, I'm getting flagged on YouTube for copyright infringement every time I upload a video with this on it. Which is okay, I'm not trying to monetize these streams. Let's try this one. So I don't mind it. Which makes me wonder if I can play anything I want instead of this generic music. I want to play more. Let's just go for it. What's the worst that can happen? This is one that played the other night that I really liked. French 79. Wait, let me hear this song first. It's not terrible. French 79, Hometown. And then maybe we can just play a bunch of... What is this mix here? Is it all French 79? Who knows? We're going to play this, though. And we're going to get back to coding. Did I close the wrong window? Probably. We're going to be coding OpenAI Gem. What's it called? OpenAI Gem. Greg. What's your name, Greg? I think I have it right here. Okay. Here we go. So I'm in the middle of carpool. Carpool is probably the most basic reinforcement learning problem. I mean, mountain cars are really simple looking one too. But for me, wanting to learn RL, then I think carpool is probably the perfect one to start with. So where I stopped was... Turn that down a little bit. Where I stopped was, I'm converting. So I've already converted Greg's code to Python 3.5. It was at 2.7. So I was having a few problems there. So I got that converted. The next thing I'm doing is slowly rebuilding the... He wrote this class called DQN Solver. And I'm going through it. I'm learning what he's doing in it. And as I learn it, I bring it up to my own class. I'm making my own class. It's going to be really close to the same as his. But I'm going to add more documentation and only put stuff in my class if I know what it does. So far I know this. Observation dimensions, so how many observations, which we have, I think I've got them here, let's add these. Again, these are cart position, cart velocity, the pole angle, and the pole velocity at the tip. So let's add these up here. Observation space. Four possible, no, four elements make up the observation state. Well, let's just do this. Zero, cart position. Make this look nice and pretty. Cart velocity. I don't think I need to capitalize these. Cart position. Velocity, pole angle. I'm guessing that's in radians, I don't know. Pole velocity at the tip. Pole velocity at tip. All right. This is in the wrong spot. This goes right here. Solver goes here. We provide this. Okay. Observation space, four elements. We have that, the action dimensions. Actions, zero, move left, one, move right. Those are the only two actions that this little cart can do to keep the pole centered and upright. So we have observation dimensions, we have action dimensions, we build a network to run it through, and on the other side of the network, we should get a prediction of one or zero. Okay, so we are... Now, exploration rate, we don't know enough about, so let's go to his code. So he's not really talking about it in the code. So I believe he links to his Medium article here. Let's see if we can find that. Let's close that. Okay, let's see if he talks about exploration. Exploration. How can you not? You have stuff in your code and you don't comment it. You don't talk about what it does. OpenAI Gem. Exploration. Actually, it's not even relegated just to OpenAI Gem. It's reinforcement learning exploration. Okay, yeah. I remember this from the book. So there's exploration, there's exploitation. Exploitation is taking advantage of what you already know. So if you already know this, moving to the left will, at a certain point, will bring this back to center. That's called exploiting what you know. Exploration is saying, what if I go left, 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 and then back one to the right? So it explores. So there's an exploration rate. Let's see what he calls exploration rate is exploration max. So what does this max mean? He only uses it one time. Oh, yeah, he sets it right here. He sets it. So he's doing np random rand. Let's see what that looks like. Python, import numpy as np. np.random is what? np random rand. Whoops. It's just a random float between what? 0 and 1. If it's less than the max. Okay. If it's less than the exploration rate, which is exploration max, so it's less than one, yes, then random, I have to import that. Random.rand range, self action space, which is 2, it's 0 or 1. So 0, 1. Okay. Else, self model predict. So now we're going to predict the Q values. Q values. And we're going to take the argmax of Q value 0. Q values. Oh, right. So Q values is going to look like this. Q values is going to be a probability between 0 and 1 that it's 0, so it might be 0.28 and 0.72 that it's 0 and 1. Q value 0. I don't understand why it's getting more than one value here. That's okay. I think we're closer to understanding it. But the good thing is now we understand exploration rate. We can move this up to our class. We'll comment it. Determine whether we should explore a value that may not be the best one to take at this particular moment. Determine whether we should explore that. Or exploit what we already know. So self-exploration rate is exploration max, which is set to 1 here. And then what else does he do in his code? So we've got that pulled down. We've got our model built. We've got our action space. All right, that's all we need to do to init this model. Looks like we're having some drop frames. All right, cool. I'm going to get rid of these drop frames. Is it really blurry? And my whole house is streaming right now. The whole house. Three other people are streaming. Netflix, an online class, and me, Twitch. So yeah, we're gonna have some problems. That'll just have to be part of life for now. It's quarantine business, man. Alright, let's go back to his code. I think what I should do is look at Cartpole here. Alright, so we've got this. Now, Def, remember. Let's talk about remember. Remember, I don't understand yet. We're going to skip it. Let's talk about act. Okay. What is act? So we're going to say, because we want to use the same algorithm that we're building for Lunar Lander or other things in Gym. So it could be act, it could be move, it needs to be a verb of some sort. Let's say make move. I don't like it yet. We're going to keep it for now. We're going to just keep it move. Self and state. All right, if MP random, here's the, why are we using NP for this? It feels heavy. If we're already using random, if we're already importing random, Python random get integer, get float. Okay, so here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna try this. T equals, let's make a new function. Def test random. Test random. T, all right, there's a better way to do this. Jupyter Notebook. We're in Ubuntu. Let's just go to this. Windows Terminal. So I've got my keyboard. Oh, come on, man. For real? Got my keyboard set up to these random colors, and every once in a while it makes the prettiest color. It's like a pink that fades to a really cool blue. Like, I'm gonna have to figure out how to get that one solid on here full time. Jupyter pip install Jupyter. It's a lot of work just to figure out if what random seed is better than, or what random generator is better than another faster. We can make an argument for NumPy, because we're importing it. We need NumPy already, but we're also importing random, aren't we? Maybe the question is, why are we importing random? Oh, because we're doing this. So we're using this for the rand range. I would honestly just rather use the same random generator instead of using it in NumPy. But we're going to do a test to see if that's the wise move. And the test will just be to generate 10 numbers and take the average time it takes to generate 10 random numbers for NumPy and for random.random. It's gonna be a difference of like a thousandth of a second, probably. But now I have to know, even though it doesn't matter at all. It's probably the wrong place to do that. Here we go. We're going to figure this out right now. We're going to say, Galaga, I know. Oh, we don't have a Galaga. Do we? Import NumPy as NP. That work? Get out of here. Yeah, we don't have Galaga. Okay. Kernel error. Kernel, we're going to change it to Python 3. We don't have that either. Kernel. Oh my goodness. I bought my son a, so I've got a Corsair, I don't know what the name of this keyboard is. Corsair Strafe RGB. It's very cool as far as the features, but the key travel is so much higher than my MacBook. So when I'm working on my MacBook all day and I come to this at night, it's such an adjustment. All right, Jupyter Notebook. What is happening, man? Kernel error. Change kernel. I just want the basic kernel. Python, conda add kernel to Jupyter. Okay, we're good. Python-m ipykernel install user name base display name Python base. All right, that will fix it. Base, here we go. Import numpy as np. Okay, so we're gonna do a numpy test first. for I in range, doesn't matter, in range 10. We're gonna say t equals time dot time. We're going to say, where's this, np dot, we're going to generate a number, np random rand, np random rand, elapsed equals time dot time minus t, total time plus equal elapsed, time is on, I don't understand why time wouldn't be a base thing that gets imported, but that's okay, whatever. All right, cool. And then in range 10, so then we're gonna say print average time to generate a random number. We'll call this total time over 10 seconds. With NumPy. 0 seconds. It's not zero. What have I done wrong? Total time plus equals elapsed. Print elapsed. Zero. Elapsed equals time dot time minus t. Is it happening? How is that possible? Elapsed equals time dot time print t. It's not advancing at all. Why? So, is it happening so fast? How is that possible? such a rabbit hole here. Python time.time doesn't advance. Doesn't increase, probably. Hold on, this looked interesting. Typically, the processor clock doesn't tick if your program isn't doing anything. The clock value does not. Oh, I see. So, time.clock does, but time.time does, right. Total time. Am I doing something really stupid? I'm definitely getting 10 values. T equals time dot time. It's going so fast that to show time process time T1 start and I end equals that for I in range this T1 start is this. Oh, hold on. Well, I guess we could do it this way. This would make sense too. What if we do this? T0 equals time dot time. We generate the numbers. I really don't care about the number. We'll look at the elapsed time. For I in range that, we move this outside the loop. Maybe it was in the, I don't know. Elapsed time equals time dot time minus T0. And then we say minus T0. Elapsed. Maybe I just was really dumb about the way I did that. Nope. Zero, of course. I mean, look at that. How is that possible? We know this is going to be more than 0 seconds. 5.39. Okay. We're definitely making this too hard. We're just going to do it this way. Let's clear that out. For blank in range 10, we'll do our own little math real quick. We're going to say np, what is it? np.random.rand. It makes me wonder if Jupiter is doing something weird. See that? Okay. I think so. For that in range 10, np.random.rand going to say, I already messed it up. T0 equals time dot time. We're going to import time. Time. T0 equals time dot time. I want to put that inside the loop so it doesn't get executed now. Range 10. T0 equals time dot time. My backyard camera went off. Alright, T0 was time dot time. np.random.rand print time dot time minus T0. It could be happening so fast. It's definitely. So it's something in Jupiter. Can Jupiter not track the time? Python Jupiter track time. Hey guys, what's up? So quiet.
CPU was actually executing your code.
Oh, wow.
So for 78.
That's awesome. Wall time. Nanoseconds?
Standard deviation of 10.3 microsecond per loop, and basically we ran it for 1,000 loops. Okay, generally
time it. Dude, this is cool. Hold on, time it times 100. Time it in. What is it? Dash n is 100. 2.8 microseconds, 76.4. Perfect. That's all I needed to do. What a great. Who are you, Indian Pythonista? You get a thumbs up. Okay, so let's do the same thing here. Let's run this again. 28277 plus or minus 112 293. Why is it going up? Okay, well, we've seen a range from 28 to 3. Let's call it 303, and then we're gonna say import random, and we can get rid of this dude. We're going to say random. Let's look at our code again. Dot rand range. Dot rand. Rand range 2. 715 microseconds. 10 microseconds. So NumPy. NumPy is faster. Get out of here, NumPy. Okay, all that work to understand that NumPy is faster. That's really cool. So how do we get NumPy to do a random range? I don't want to use random anymore. So NumPy, random range. We could do the old, like, there's a mathematical way to do this. Return values in a given shape, rand int, low and high. It does. R-E-N-D-I-N-T. NumPy random randint. Parameters low and high. Lowest integer to be drawn from the distribution unless high equals none. Provided one of the largest signed integer. low inclusive to high inclusive. Do I not understand low and inclusive and exclusive? Well, that works. Okay. Goodbye, random. Leave my code. Sister, kind of like a. I'm gonna go down here. Actually, let's keep it nice and clean. Alphabetical. Okay. And then from scores, we're doing score. We're gonna get to scores later. Okay. So all that to determine the NumPy is the coolest. So act, which is we're gonna call move, if NP. Where's act? Those are really blurry. If NP random rand is less than the exploration rate. If NP random dot rand is less than self dot exploration rate, then return NP dot random dot randint 02. Let's try something real quick. Okay. Okay, so we have a random int and q values. Don't quite understand this yet. Q values, this is where we're gonna have fun though. So we're gonna say y because that's what comes out of a network. Y's equals self.model dot predict state. Are we getting the state? We're getting E and V. Their state is act. Oh, okay. That's right there. All right, cool. Move. Okay, so for that, then return else that. We're going to return the argmax. So the highest probability of y's not zero. Now this is where I don't understand, but we're gonna understand it pretty soon. Y predicted y values. And we're gonna print y's. Okay. We're not doing any memory right now. And what I want to do, if it's less than, you know what, all we have to do is this. So we're going to say Python. Oops, we're already there. Import. I feel like we can do it all in Jupyter. Yeah, we'll just do this. All right, we're going to do a new notebook, new base. I don't want base. I want the OpenAI. So we're going to look through this code right here. We're going to kill this. Kill this window. Leave. Okay. We're gonna look for this code again that we ran already. It's Gandhi. There it is. Display name, we're gonna call this Python OpenAI. And then the environment name is OpenAI. That'll install into that. We're gonna go to we have an OpenAI? CD Open. Alright, cool. Jupyter. Nope. New OpenAI. We'll call this model. We're going to define it here, class solver. Right here. Whoops, right here. Intention error, self observation dimensions line 21. What? Oh, let's bring this in too. Let's bring all this in. Insert, cell above, right here. So that came in. No module named Keras. OpenAI, we don't have Keras. Keras right there, man. So basically tonight I'm fighting the tools. Really not fighting learning. Okay, I see what happened. So in this environment right here, I'm in Ubuntu. This environment right here, I'm in backend Windows. So it does make sense. Python import Keras. Oh my goodness. Okay, pip install. Now with this one, I can actually install a GPU version. I'm gonna do that too. So Python, TensorFlow install GPU. I think it's just an extra flag. 115, okay, TensorFlow GPU. So here, TensorFlow-GPU. All right, while that's going, what am I missing in the Twitch world right now? Who's going? Yeah, let's go here. Who's 3D printing masks? Someone's gotta be 3D printing COVID masks. What is Temple OS?
Schedule tranquility into manner work, deeply prepared aghast, ill recess, deserves the fossil, harmonized hearest, thin beatings.
Is this like a... what kind of word processor is that? What is going on here? Terry A. Davis, Temple OS. What? Whoa. Beacon.nist.gov. Beacon.nist.gov. CSRC interoperable randomness beacons.
Exhausted ditto. Okay, I don't know. I'm not supposed to interpret, I guess. I don't feel like it.
I have no idea what's happening with that. It looks. What are we looking at here? I feel so lost.
We'll go to the kernel source code directory.
This guy knows a lot more than me. He's like, I think this might be assembly.
You see this blue entry? That's a macro. And what that does is it does whatever text it want, it sends to a new spawn shell in a pop-up window. And it executes that text. So in this case, it does a rep, and then it does a view. We just looked at it by hitting Control T toggles plain text in regular mode. Now if you click on it, it doesn't correct. And in this case, we wanted to direct the attention.
I love this, man. It's so weird and out of my league.
This entry is executed just as a convenience. You see it's blue because it's a macro, and the red ones are links. Just in this case, it's to a symbol. Anyway, that's consistent with the command line. These red ones are links to files, and these blue ones are macros, which change directory and then do a directory. So for directories, it will list a directory. And you can see it's consistent with the with your main menu.
I gotta blow this up. See what's happening.
It has blue and red as well. And now we'll look at
Losthos operating system. Losthos operating system DOE.
Superscripts and subscripts. And breaking and underlying.
What?
And widgets like.
Maybe it's not assembly, actually. This, I mean, this is an editor.
You can see it sent it to the command line. So this is the command line. Anyway, so. You can also put.
He's just going on.
Superscripts and subscripts in labels.
Okay.
And the compiler understands them, so if you want to do.
Install a Jupyter.
I don't advise it, it just doesn't seem like a good idea.
Is he answering my question?
If you want to do extended characters, that's for ASCII or for.
Temple OS archive. Why is he looking at beacons? What are they? I don't even know what they are.
You can put extended characters in labels.
Trusted public randomness as a public utility.
So we just did a little smiley face. Anyway, so you might. Now you can also put graphics in.
Temple OS. Okay.
And you can send it to the command line. So, like in this case, this program.
That's a biblical themed.
Graphics to the command line. So.
Lightweight OS. Oh, it's by Terry Davis. He's doing the stream right now. This is Terry Davis. 20 years ago. Graphics on the command line. Yes, please. Oh, I think he's reading my stuff. I'll bring this over here for a minute. We've lost all interest in Python AI. Oh, don't go away, Terry. Okay, go back to this. Temple OS is a biblical-themed, lightweight OS designed to be the third temple prophesied in the Bible. What's the third temple? It's an unrealized...
Sidebar with the vector commands can be edited with...
Unrealized Jewish temple for Herod the Great's massive renovation in the second temple. The third temple, literally the house, the holy, the third, would be the third... after Solomon and the rebuilt Second Temple. Although it remained unbuilt, the notion of a third temple is sacred in Judaism as anticipated as a place of worship. Why don't they build it? What's stopping them? Some kind of land battle? Medieval attempts at rebuilding. Modern. Oh, the Jewish Messiah has to build it.
Anyway, we're gonna take this from off the command line.
It's the most random
file.
OS idea ever.
No, it's
a series of episodes he describes a revelation from God. Look what it's written in. It's written in Holy C.
Anyway, now let's take a look at the format this is stored in. Edit this text. Here's the color.
I can't. This isn't happening, is it? It's not.
With this is the raw data. You can modify this by hand if you want. We'll make with 5 or 10.
4-bit colors.
No, it's all white. Anyway, the reason I did that.
What?
I want to look at the. This file is stored.
Terry Davis died.
It ends in a CPP and not a CPZ.
So what?
You do a directory.
Oh no.
To convert it to compressed, you.
Wait, who are you then?
Copy or move. It changed the last letter.
Terry, are you back? You back, Terry? What is happening?
Now let's look at the you can access disk blocks yourself directly with. We just did a full directory, which shows...
Has no networking or internet support. So it's a 64-bit, 2-meg, multicolored public domain, open source, ring zero only, single address space, non-networked PC, operates for recreational programming, 8-bit ASCII with graphics and source code, and has a 2D and 3D graphics library, runs at 640, 480 VGA, you're hitting all the right buttons for me.
If you use another parameter on
these were all instructed by God, and he explained limited resolution must make it easier for children to draw illustrations for God.
So
hence the sword.
accessible on the disk. You can access any block you want.
So
now you can also access any memory you want. And one interesting thing is the task record for the current task.
I'm wasting some time here. I haven't wasted it. I'm glad I learned about this. But
it holds the current address of the current task record.
So who's maintaining it now?
Under the command line. So we're going to dump. There's a command that lets you display a record, and it accesses the compiler's task structure. It accesses
the 256.
Information and lets you edit it.
Whoa. Oh, I'm on third temple.
You can change the left window coordinate.
What a rabbit hole. So much to learn.
Anyway, the command line has...
Man, I thought I was watching Terry Davis. That would have been cool. Temple may require you to enter IO port addresses for the CD drive.
Is it dynamic?
And the hard drive. Windows, you can find it. Blah, blah, blah.
Shows data live.
It's holy C.
Modify it. Or, anyway.
In the wake of Terry Davis' passing, his family has requested supporters of his to donate to organizations working to ease the pain, such as Brain Behavior Research and National Alliance on Mental Illness. We're taking a diversion.
Purify myself in a horribly impure environment. It's pretty rough living homeless and
oh man.
In a field outside a little town, and
poor Terry.
Into their library, and it's a very pure town, and must have been an extreme shock to them to see such a horribly sick person come in here and pollute everything, and it was a lot of torture to snap me into an ability to handle purity for this job. There's a little castle over there. Let's see, where's that castle? There it is. Oh no! So, that's a little castle. I don't know. I really like this library.
It was a nice library. Beat yourself up, Terry.
No, I used to have a respect for purity. So, well, it's good to be king. Maybe. I think maybe I'm just like a little bizarre little person who walks back and forth. Whatever, you know.
Poor guy. He's hurting. That's sad. Is that all we get? Well, makes me sad. Such a weird little trip. This guy's still going. What is he doing? Why is he still doing that? Forget it, man. Forget it. Okay. I have so much to learn or unlearn. What is this? What are these? Who's using these? 6 years ago. Okay. I got it. I'm going to stay on. Oh, what's up, Bowser? I just went down a weird, a weird diversion, but I'm back. Have you ever heard of, I don't know how much you saw. Have you ever heard of Temple OS? Because I just learned about Temple OS. Okay, man, that was a weird diversion. I don't even know. Oh, I was waiting for this to install Jupyter, so we should be able to do Jupyter Notebook. I haven't either. Temple OS. Here, let me show you real quick. Control-Shift-T. Can I get back to it? Maybe here? Here we go. So this guy's talking about it, but he's playing music too. Yeah, I'm going to keep it muted. So this is an operating system called Temple OS. Terry Davis Temple OS. So I go here. Terry Davis. Oh, I don't want that. I just went Temple OS. GitHub. No, I went Wiki. And it's this operating system. And it's written by this guy named Terry Davis. So I thought I'm watching Terry Davis code and play music. But apparently, he died in 2018. And anyway, it's this OS. It's this biblical-based OS. I don't want to call it weird. I don't want to offend anybody, but it's the weirdest thing. And my favorite part of it is it's written in Holy C. Which is amazing. But unfortunately, Terry Davis died, so I just watched a Terry Davis video. That was a rabbit hole I got on. Oh, that dude just came back. What if this was Terry Davis? Could be him, right? We're going to ask it. The question has to be asked. I think so. I think he was a brilliant developer. I don't want to offend him. He's probably a big fan of Terry Davis. I'm going to offend him if I ask him that. Anyway, I was waiting for this this utility called Jupyter to install, and it was taking a while, so I go to Twitch, and I got stuck in that rabbit hole for the past 10 minutes. Yeah, it looks like a brilliant developer. Like, he made this OS. You can make OS regardless of what it's based on. I think you're probably pretty brilliant. Okay, let's get back to the real stuff. What if it is Terry Davis? What if he came back to life and we're the first two people to discover it, Bowser? He's alive. We'll never know. Alright, let's get back to fun Python. So we're going to go Jupyter Notebook. Oh, don't do that to me. Jupyter Notebook. Alright, cool. And this should work now. So we're going to look at this code. Want this right here. All this should work. Oh, actually, that score logger won't work. That's okay. We'll go here. If you don't know Bowser, Jupyter is a really cool way to experiment in Python without having to use an IDE. Basically, you can just use these notebooks. They call them notebooks. So I can test things out, like simple stuff. Whoops, why don't we print that? Oh, there's no kernel. Kernel, change kernel to OpenAI. Kernel ready. No module named Keras. Let's see what happened. Import Keras. It's right there. So I don't understand why I would say there's no Keras. OpenAI. Let's try it again. We're gonna change the kernel here. New OpenAI. Import Keras. Good, that's better. How long have you been writing code for college professionally? Man, I started early, like at 8 with BASIC. And then I really didn't get into really good languages. Like, I skipped Java, obviously, so I'm not good at Java. I really didn't get into Python until 2015. So I've been doing Python for 4 years. But totally, yeah, maybe 25, 30 years. But I would not consider myself a good programmer. I don't have a CS degree, and I couldn't do, like, if you are learning algorithms, tree sort, bubble sort, those kind of things, I don't know any of those. I could figure them out if someone showed them to me, but I don't study those or learn those, so you would be a better, if you're taking, like, the real classes, you're going to be way ahead of me. But, for the most part, the best learning that I've found is to just find a project you want to do and then learn how to do it with the tool. So I want to learn this. I wanted to learn Python a few years ago, and so I started just, what did I make? What was my first Python program? Oh, I was looking at, so, you know, I work for Amazon, and so EC2 prices, EC2 pricing, it changes by region. So if you are in US East or US West, like if you're in Ohio or Northern Virginia or like Seattle, Oregon, whatever those regions are, the prices change. Where's our pricing at? On demand. So what I thought, I wanted to write like a stock market ticker for EC2 pricing to get the latest. There's things called spot prices, and that's, man, I really wish, here we go. So you can rent this A1 medium for 3 cents an hour. But you can also reserve it at a lower price called a spot price. You can say, I want to pay for this A1 medium. I'm only going to bid 0.17 cents an hour. And if AWS is like, oh, that's cool, we have some extras laying around, we'll give it to you. But if capacity starts going away, then we'll just take it back from you. We'll give you, I think it's 90 minutes notice, and we'll take it back from you and charge the other customer that wants to pay more for it. So I wanted to write a stock ticker for that. So that was my first Python project. But from there, it's really been a, I don't know why the star is still here. It's been a really good tool for machine learning and AI. This star should not still be there. Nothing's running. You just learned bubble, selection, inserting, sort this week in class. That's awesome. And binary search. See, I've heard of those terms. I don't know any of them. And if I wanted to be a engineer at Amazon, I would need to know those. They'll ask you to whiteboard something usually. I wish I invested time outside of class. So you've got time to do more personal projects. You just need to think of a project, and then man, I'll tell you, you can be the greatest programmer in the world just by using Stack Overflow. That's what I do. But yeah, think of a project. You've probably got some cool ones, like one it could be real simple too. I think everything's messed up right now. Replacing stale connection. So, what is binary search? That one seems weird to me. Are you searching? Does that mean you're searching a binary file? Like if I had an exe file in Windows. No. Or it's binary search, a one or zero, like a tree search where you're just taking one of two paths. That's probably it. That makes way more sense. Oh, man. Your software engineering internship has been canceled due to COVID. That really stinks. Did they mention if they'll, like, honor it or pick it back up after all this mess goes away? That really sucks, man. I'm sorry. Was it a Java-based or just engineering in general? Do you know? All right, that worked. Let's try these four. I mean, it should take a little bit. There we go, that worked too. All right, I'm on the right track. All right, so class solver. I'm going to copy this. Actually, we need this learning rate. We need these environments, probably. All right, 21, line 21. What is line 21? Why can't we see that? I'm not going to turn that on. Can I see that? View. Line numbers, yes, okay. Line 21, this indention doesn't match. Oh, this little guy right here is a problem. Same thing there. Binary search, sorting an array by dividing the search interval in half multiple times until the... Oh, okay. So it's like when you play that game, I'm guessing a number between 1 and 100, and you tell me if it's high or low. And so I'll guess 50, and you're going to tell me it's high. Let's say you guess 20, 22, whatever. Then I just keep dividing it by half. So then I say 25, and you say it's low. Then I say, okay, it's 17. Then you say it's high. Then low, 17, 25 is 8, 21. Yep. But the array must be sorted before performing binary, which is what bubble selection and insertion is for. I understand insertion. What is bubble? That is cool. So that's binary search, huh? I'm playing that game for a while. It's good. You're gonna help me pass the SDE interview. Okay. So we fixed the indention, so this should be fine. So now let's create a new solver. So we're gonna say solver. Solver equals solver, and we need an action. So we need environment. We need this right here. env. Let's make an environment. Let's print the environment too. Print the environment. So now we're at our part call environment, and we can see things like actions. Print env dot action space. Should be discrete too. And then observations. Print env.observation space. And then box four. I figured those out yesterday. Okay. So that's the environment. Now we want to make a new. We want to do a new solver. So solver equals solver. Whoops. We'll pass the environment in there. Good. Bowser, they're all different algorithms in organizing an array from least to greatest, then to perform binary. Oh, they're all different algorithms to go from least to greatest. Okay. So the first pass, you have to run multiple times, repeatedly swapping the adjacent elements if they're in the wrong order. Oh, so you do bitwise like comparison, maybe. So 5 and 1. So we do 1, 5, then we have 1, 5, 4, then we swap the 4. Oh, that's cool. Okay. Ah, you're not new. We're in the same boat. That's really cool. So here's bubble sort in Python. So we take the length of the array. So we have an array of numbers. We take for each index in the array. Okay. That's really cool. Okay, solver. And all I wanted to see was solver. We're going to run this model. So let's look at solver. Solver.model. What was it? Keras. I need to close some of these now. Keras model description. About Keras models. Get weights, set weights. That's the fourth one. 1, 2, 3, 4. Summary. Model.summary. Alright, so this is our neural network. The neural network has a 32 neuron layer here, 32 neuron layer here. It outputs the 1 or the 0 to move left or right. It takes input of 4, but I don't see that input shape here anywhere, even though we know it is right here. The input shape is 4. So let's see. Let's act. So we have a method called move. So we want to find out the proper move given a certain scenario. So we're going to say solver. I don't like move. Let's say predict move. Get predicted move. So this will be get a 0 or 1, left or right, based on the current state. Predict. Okay. So get predicted move. We have to reinitialize that and reinitialize that. Reinitialize that. Okay. So solver, get predicted move, and we need to give it the initial state. So we're going to say env dot observation space. Can that be right? And then we want to return this 0, 1. So it's just guessing. What I want to see though, oh, print the y's. Okay, print the, let's see, predicted y values. This. So Bowser, when you get when all this clears up too, I can look for a an internship for you at Amazon too. So just let me know whenever you're ready to look at that. I'll put you in touch with the right people. I'm not getting get predicted move should be showing me something here. Print predicting move. Let's see if it prints that. Predicting move, good. And then we're returning this right here. This is the problem. So it's just, all it's doing is giving us a random number between 0 and 1. Here we go. This is what I want. All right. Let's see. We got an error. Box is no attribute in dim. Where is that happening? So y's is predict, then we're going to training utils. Let's just take a look at the state here. Actually, we can do it right here. So we're sending it box. We don't really want that. We want the values of that. So we want observation space shape 0. Look inside this box. Let's see. So we have shape, we have low, we have high. Sample. Observation space shape. Human solver. Predict state. Alright, so state is coming from act. So if we say act state right there, state is. I want to see what this is. While true. Environment reset. Oh, we're not doing that. Okay. Okay, I see what's happening here. We have to reset the environment before it can even populate it. So, go here. State equals, yeah. Okay. Predicted one based on the current state. State equals env.reset print state. Let's see what this looks like. And then we need to reshape it. What's the shape of this? Function has no attribute shape, okay. MP reshape state 1 to 4. I don't understand that yet. conservation space is not defined. I think it's just 1 to 4. But we need to make that dynamic. There we go. I just didn't call the right function. So here's, so we're resetting it. Is it the same every time? It's different. It's just a random 4 values between the bounds based on the environment. So our cart velocity, cart position is -0.01x. Okay, that makes sense. Now we can do a prediction. So now that we have a state, we can say model, let's see. Solver equals solver, and then solver.predict, get predicted move, I should say, get predicted move state. We need to say the env goes right here. All right, so this is important to initialize the state vars. For example, these guys. All right, predicting move has an error. Error when checking the input. Expected dent 16 to have the shape 4, but got it with shape 1. Okay, so we just need to reshape it, just like he does here. This needs to be reshaped. We need to reshape. Reshape the state from 1 row 4 calls to 4 1 row 4 calls to 4 rows 1 call. So we'll use state equals np.reshape state. We're going to restate the shape variable. Is it parentheses 1 or bracket 1? Where's reshape? I'm trying to copy and paste on this one, bracket. So bracket 1 and then the state.shape 1. That should be the 4. Tuple index out of range. So it's 4 comma. So it's this guy. Okay, so the predicted wipeout, it's saying with 0.005, there's a 0.005 chance that it should go, that it's 0, and a negative 0.008. So we need the argmax of that, our probability. Okay, so we need the argmax, which he's probably getting, argmax, nope, right here. Action we're getting, get predicted move, and then he predicts it by doing act, here we go, np argmax q value 0. This is the part I wanted to experiment with. So there's our state, get predicted, okay, gets probabilities for a 0 or 1, e.g. these guys, and then we use np argmax q values. Okay, so moves equals prediction equals that, and then we know since it's in a it's in a nested array, we need the 0 element. So we'll say get the argmax of this. Oops. Argmax of the prediction of that. Let's see. Result equals that. So I want to see the prediction. I want to see the result. Print prediction. Print result. So it's this, the first element is higher. It's the max of those two. So that makes sense. So the move is the one. So it's saying, given state, let's just print given state of state, predicted move is result. Oh, I'm not. Yeah. Python 3.5 can't do that. Given state. State. Print. Prediction. Result. Result equals invalid indexed scalar variable. I thought that just worked for us. Get rid of some of this. Oh, here we go. So y's equals, okay, so we're gonna do this here. Predictions equal that and return the argmax of that. So we're already getting the value. But I don't really want to do that necessarily. I want to return the y's. So return the predictions. Given state of that, prediction is that. Okay. Let's see, Bowser. So AI machine learning, do you need to be a math master? I'm terrible at math. It helps you be a math master, but you don't have to. You need to know at least the basics of matrix multiplication or matrix math, but... So I'm doing a class right now on self-driving cars on Coursera. Wish I could show you. Maybe I can. Let me show you some of this math that's blowing me away, that I'm so stuck on. Like, stuck to the point where I'm not going to give up on this class, but I'm probably going to skip these lectures because it's ridiculous. Are you good at math is the question. So let's see. It's week 2. Kalman filters. Readings. Let's don't go a reading. Let me just show you one of the videos. So imagine a professor that teaches you, that's trying to teach you some complex math, but you can't ask him any questions. There we go. Like this. Like, I think in this, like I had to refresh myself on what the hat meant and what this meant, and then. And some of these lectures, though, they won't even explain what this L value means, for example. They might in this one, but... So then I have to, like, okay, what's L? How do I find the sum of L? Here we go. There's some more. So I think if you... Oh, nice. Your best friend, say, autonomous developer for Uber. He probably understands this. He or she. I do not understand most of it. I understand. So what I'm doing is understanding the concepts of it. So I'm trying to understand the basic principles of it. And then, because I know in these, like... these Python libraries, you could do Kalman filters without having to know the math. I think it'd be cool to know the math. There's a really good, well, I thought there's going to be a good paper here. Let me find it. This one. So this is from an engineer or an artist at Pixar. So how Kalman filters work in pictures. So he starts off and he gets me super excited. He says, let's see. This the one? Yeah, this is the one. The math for implementing the Kalman filter appears pretty scary and opaque in most places you find on Google. That's a bad state of affairs because the Kalman filter is actually super simple and easy to understand. So I got super excited about this. So I go through and I understand this part, no problem. It's talking about how you estimate the state of the robot. So then it talks about this range. These are mean values. So like the brighter the white, the higher the probability is that it's in this position, but it could be over here, but higher probability here. Yeah, unlikely to likely. So I'm understanding this so far, no problem. And then we do some correlations. I'm kind of losing it a little bit. And then he talks about this interpolation. So basically you say, if this is where the robot could be at time t, then time t plus 1. Of course a math master would say that. Yeah, this guy's a math master. So then you're saying, okay, you're going to translate all these values to t plus 1, time t plus 1. This is a predicted state. And then you're going to look back and see where it eventually ends up. You're going to combine the two Gaussian of clouds, basically. Here's where I start losing it. I kind of kept up with it for here for sure. And then I start to lose it. And then. And by this point, I'm just scrolling and looking at the pretty colors. I don't understand any of this. But I understand the concepts. I know what they're doing. I just don't know how to do the math. But I don't think I have to. This is actually a good way to think about it, too. There's like, if you have a curve where the area under the curve is possible locations, or maybe it's on the line, possible locations for your robot, and you have the predicted one, and then you merge them together, and this might be a better estimation. What was this N? I knew this N for a little bit today. Noise. There's some noise in there. Anyway. Yeah. He told us it was super easy, and it might be, but I spent a few hours on it and didn't get more than a third of the way into it. So anyway, I guess you asked me a simple question. How are you at math? I'm not good. But you don't have to be. It helps. You don't have to be. You just have to work harder. Okay, so we're getting a prediction of 0-1. We're able to get a prediction that's fantastic. So now, what's the next step? So we're acting, we've got this. So Bowser, what I'm doing is taking this guy's code, he's got really good code, and I'm taking it block by block. So each of these defs are a block, and I'm putting it into my code. This is the QNS solver. And I'm making a new solver. And is this the right one? This may not be the right one. But I'm making a new solver where I am doing it myself and only moving stuff into my class if I understand what it does. So as soon as I understand something in his code, I bring it to my code. If you want to get good at AI, this is the best teacher for this. So take Andrew's ML course. It's free. Go at your own pace. He's a really good teacher, top instructor. Starts you off with the very, very basics. Linear regression with one variable. We're doing a linear regression with four variables, so we're not too far away from that. But I guess we're doing more of a classification. But anyway, if you want to get into it and have time, it's good. I know you've got regular classes and stuff to attend, but this is good. I'm a little worried. Where'd my code go? There we go. All right, this is my solver. So my solver is moving right along. I'm going to close that window. So we've got a prediction. And so what does he do next after he gets a prediction? So let's go here. Cart pull. He sets up a logger. We're not going to do the logger yet. He runs his solver. Run equals 0. Then he sets up a loop. And inside the loop, he increases the run. He resets the state. He reshapes it. EMV renders blocked out. Okay. Action. So this is where, okay, we're going to create our loop now. So let's bring our good code over. So solver is get predicted move. We're going to keep that here now. Return np random int. Okay, so we need to actually return the argmax. Oops. Control C. There we go. We're returning our random int, or our predicted value, if we get to that point. You have a ML AI class in 2 semesters. Oh, you mean 2 semesters from now you've got one? Oh, you're going to learn so much. It's so great having a real teacher to teach you. where you can actually ask questions. I mean, these courses on Coursera are great, but unless you can talk to someone about where you're running into problems or ask how they're doing this weird math, then it's a lot trickier. Also, when you're applying for the sub button, yeah, I think I need a lot more followers. I don't care. I mean, making money on here is fine, but that's not a goal. I really want to get a lot of followers, and eventually subs would be the goal. But I just have fun coding. I code poor when people are watching me, but I learn more. Like, I take my time and learn more. Maybe because I feel like I'm teaching. And then I saw you did some, Destiny? No, it wasn't Destiny, Fortnite. I downloaded Call of Duty today, Warzones, and I tried to play it, and I could not get past the training mission. It's telling me to, have you played it yet? It's telling me to find some mission in the training zone, and I cannot find the stupid laptop with the mission on it. So I gave up after about 10 minutes. Side note is, I'm in an attic, a converted attic, and it's hot up here, and it was kind of the middle of the day, and it was real hot. I was stressed out. I only had 15 minutes to play anyway, so I think if I start off in the morning when it's cool and take some time, I can figure that out. But I played that a little today. And then other games, I don't play Fortnite. I'm terrible at Fortnite. The last time I played online in Fortnite, these two guys, I was like, I guess it was a three-man squad, and I was so terrible, and they both died. I was alive. I was the only one alive, and I was there, so they were watching me, and I went down the wrong way, and like, the map clearly says to go left, and I'm going right or turning around, and they're just laughing, and they're like, who is this guy? He's terrible. I really was terrible. So I haven't played since then. I used to play Fortnite. Are you playing Destiny 2? Doom? I'm playing Doom a little bit. Okay, there's our prediction. Everything's good there. Class solver, bring this back over. Okay, so after this, solver making a solver. I don't really like that name. I'm sure I'll think of a better one later, but we're going to prediction. I don't really need that either. I don't need the summary. Okay, we're going to start with his little loop. So, let's get all this. We're going to reset the state. I'm going to reshape it. Where's observation space? We're going to say this is env.observation. We did the same thing here, I think. Reshape, state shape. I guess we can do this. Okay, step equals 0, while true, step equals 1, env render. I want to turn that on. I want to see the little cart pole moving. Action is going to be, so we're going to say prediction. Actually, you know what? Action is a good word for this. Action equals DQN solver. Solver.predict based on the state. State next, reward terminal, and info is env step action. Reward is this. Okay. I want to see if we're getting a reward each time. Let's try this. What's this called? Python Carpal. Oh, cool, cool, cool. Okay, so state next, reward, terminal info is env state. So we're getting the action. We're returning, we're stepping through, so we're making one step with the action. We're getting the reward. We got a reward of 1, which means we're right in the middle, or we're within plus or minus 2.14 of the middle. State next. So state next is what? So, print state. State. Print. This is where I, this is what I didn't understand. This will help me. So after we run through the system, we're going to step one time right here. Step through one iteration with our prediction. It's really not a prediction, unless it goes through the network. That's okay. We're going to keep it that. Okay. I think with our action, print state next. Let's see how these are different. So the first state was that, and the second state is just another state. So based on if we're moving left or right, the state will change, which makes sense. Let's look at our action. Print action. Let's see if we move left or right. And then we should see this first variable change based on whether it's a 1 or a 0. So our action was 0, so it's moving left, so the value of x should lower. Right? Oh, and it could have started off at a different... No, that doesn't make sense. Action 0 is left. We went action 0, but the... cart position increased. 0029 to 0034. Why is that? We went left. Right, get a little further down the line, see if we can figure that out. It doesn't make sense, though. Zero and 04790. It's still going the wrong way. 479 to 473. Negative. It's going to the right. Okay. That's okay for now. So state next we have here, reshape state next, one observation space, which is one state shape 0. Then we're going to, okay, then we're going to remember. This is the one piece I don't have yet either. So solver.remember. So let's look at his remember function. He has a remember function, and what's it do? All it does is append memory to a queue, or they call it a deck. So we need this deck. So self.remember, oh, we have it here. Oh, it's DQN, okay. QVUV. So we have memory, and then we just need to remember it. So we need a method called remember. So we'll create one here called remember. I don't like that one. Let's see, add to queue. Remember's fine. So self, state, action, reward, next. So we're taking all the state variables that we have, and we're going to say self.memory.append. State, action, reward, next, state, and done. All right, I really need to know more about this DQ. So if I wanted to play with that and like iterate through it, return to DQ or deck object. The name is pronounced deck and is short for double-ended queue. Thread safe memory efficient appends and pops from the other side. So append, we're not really appending. Oh yeah, we're appending. We're appending one element. DQGHI. Okay. What if I do this? So it's an array of 1, 2, 3, 4. What happens if I don't do double parentheses? What happens? It takes two arguments, but four were given. So the two arguments are an iterable with max length. Okay. So we're not setting a max length necessarily here. So the okay, this makes sense. So d.pop. Okay. D.append. All right, that makes sense. So we're remembering this. Where does he remember? Oh, right there. Okay. And then we say, okay, we'll go back here. Reward equals that. State next we get. And we're going to say solver. Dot remember. And here are the things we want to remember. State equals state next. We're moving the state. That makes sense. If terminal. So terminal, I don't like. So we're going to say state reward done. I guess it's really not done because we didn't solve it. Its terminal is the end. Ended. There we go. That makes more sense to me. If not ended, and then we're change this if ended, print run, and we print the number of runs, expiration, solver expiration rate. What is that? Exploration rate. Okay. Scores, string step. Score logger, add score, step, and run. Solver, experience replay. This is definitely one I don't have. Okay, so we're gonna take a look at the memory. All right, I'm not going to do that one tonight. Let's try this. State next. Observation space is env observation space shape 0. Same thing here. Still having a problem. 139 state next. NP reshape state next. Is that what he has? One and state shapes. Oh, it's. It's like I didn't save it. Here. Oh, I did not want to do that. Okay, we have to do this here. Export that. So, the auto backend carpool 140 terminal is not defined. Oh, it's called ended. Terminal. Let's see, ended here. If not ended. Oh, it's this dude's. I don't want to mess with his. Terminal. Alright. That should solve it. Okay. It's trying. It's not doing terrible. But I'm not sure why it's not doing terrible. I think it has something to do with this memory append. Oh, I don't know. Okay, well, that's a good stopping point. It works, but I'm not quite sure why yet. So we'll say manages to balance, not sure quite how. All right, Bowser, thanks for joining. I'm going to do the stream again. I'm going to continue where I left off tomorrow at 9 a.m.-ish Central. And maybe try to figure out why I think it's working. But I'm not quite catching something on the experience replay. So tomorrow we'll start tomorrow. I don't think I spelled that right. Start on def experience replay. That'll be a note for me tomorrow. All right, have a good night.